Bien, bonjour, bon après-midi à tous. Bienvenue après ce déjeuner dans cette salle pour donc ce panel sur l'euro avec trois intervenants. Je les présentais dans l'ordre dans lequel ils sont assis ici. Olivier Blanchard, donc, qui est maintenant au Peterson Institute. Un titre, je ne me rappelle pas, senior, je ne sais pas, avec un name senior fellow. Après avoir été chief economist du FMI et professeur au MIT. Ashok Modi, qui a été un responsable très senior au Fonds monétaire international, qui a mené les négociations sur notamment le programme irlandais, qui est maintenant à Princeton et qui vient de publier un livre très épais, très bien documenté, vraiment un livre sur la crise de la zone euro, qui est à ce jour, je crois, le livre le plus complet analytiquement et qui remonte dans l'histoire sur les origines du projet et ses défaillances, puisque c'est un livre qui est très critique sur l'entreprise de l'euro, ou en tout cas sur un certain nombre d'hypothèses qui étaient à sa base et qui étaient des hypothèses qu'il juge aventureuses. Enfin, Jean-Claude Trichet, que je n'ai vraiment pas besoin de présenter, mais on est très heureux qu'il soit là, puisque dans cette entreprise de l'euro, je crois qu'on peut dire qu'il a vécu absolument toutes les étapes. Quand je dis il a vécu, c'est un petit peu insuffisant, un petit peu dépréciateur, puisqu'il a été non seulement à l'origine, mais aussi ensuite un acteur absolument majeur de cette aventure, et donc qui va également contribuer à ce panel. Je vais peut-être passer à l'anglais, puisque Ashok Modi ne parlant pas français, on est convenu de faire le panel en anglais. Et donc, pour engager la discussion sur le fond, so it's the 11th World Policy Conference. I don't know how many times there were panels about the euro, but we are in 2018, certainly for 7 or 8 years at least, there have been panels of this sort. Why are we coming back to this issue? Perhaps one reason, to link what we will be discussing to what was discussed in previous sessions, and also it's not going to be the focus of what we are going to be discussing, is what does it take to be a fully fledged international currency? And is the euro such a currency? Does it have a chance to be such a currency? I think that's an important dimension of the project and something we may wish to go back at some point too. The second reason is that we still have discussions going on euro reform. There were initiatives taken, especially there were French initiatives recently. There is a completion of the discussion and the negotiation undertaken on banking union. So all that is not yet done. And the question is, what should be the priorities? And the third reason, and not the least, is that we are facing a new situation in Italy. Not so much about the sort of short-term dispute between the Italian government and the EU about the budget, but so more fundamentally about how Italy has fared in the euro area, what should be the options for Italy, what the way in which an economy like Italy can recover inside, or some would say outside the euro area. So though there are reasons for having this debate, let me say a few words on the nature of the discussion we're having and the issue of the priorities. On the nature of the discussion, there are essentially three camps, and they have been there for quite some time. I think they're still there. One that says it was a bad idea in the first place. European countries were not, in fact, sufficiently integrated, sufficiently similar to form a currency union. So this is a debate that started with the very first day of the project, and it's still, in a way, going on. The second view is that the architecture is incomplete, so that it was a project sort of half-backed because some steps were taken, but some important steps were not taken. And the question then becomes, what are the missing elements that need to be added so that the euro becomes much more resilient and much more able to deliver prosperity? And the third is that the design was good, but the behavior was bad, so that policies did not follow what should have been followed after having joined a common currency. So that it's more a matter of having the right policies at home, the question perhaps becoming then, what are the incentives to put those policies in place? Now, as regard the priorities, and I will end with that, again, there are different views, and I think we are depending on the analysis that is made of the situation. One view is that essentially the priority should be financial, that financial integration that was definitely incomplete at the start of the euro, that was a neglected part, especially everything that had to do with the supervision and the resolution of banking crisis. This should still be the priority, and that completing the financial integration, policy integration of the financial side, I should say so, remains a top priority. The second view is that it is a fiscal element that's missing. So a budget, a fiscal capacity, you can name it the way you want, for reasons having to do with stabilization, for reasons having to do with the possibility of having an instrument that would complement the common monetary policy, and for reasons having to do with transfers. So that's also a sort of long-standing view that what's missing is the fiscal side. We should not forget a third element, which is the macro side, that we have the fast-moving issues and the sort of slow-moving dimensions. The slow-moving dimensions, that's price and wage adjustment, that the build-up of current account imbalances, that the resulting assets and liabilities, net foreign asset positions, and that this is this macro functioning that has to be reformed. That brings us into a different territory having to do with wage and price formation in different countries. So the institutions that contribute to wage setting and price setting, perhaps also to investment. And finally, and I should mention that also, is the view that the issue is fundamentally political, and that what we have to address in the current political context are the political institutions that the Eurozone doesn't have, is not equipped with, and what are the political dimensions of the problem we're facing, and what are the political responses to the problem we're facing. That's a very long agenda, but let me stop here. I'm sure we are going to address some parts of it, so we're going to skip large parts of it, and each of you will speak for 7-8 minutes. Then we'll have a moment of debate, and then I'll open the floor to the questions. Ashok, we agreed that you would start.